Okay, thank you, Michael, for the introduction, and good morning to all of you. And as Michael indicated, I would like to present you our approach to identify and prioritize substances for regulatory action. And I first will address ECHA's regulatory strategy. So that is, means how to select substances that matter, and then what we call the REACH machinery, so how our processes are interlinked in order to address substances and to channel them to the appropriate and necessary regulatory action. Then I will go a little bit further in detail to our screening approach, who stands at the beginning of the regulatory strategy, and then shortly address how we consider substance groups in the screening process, but as well in other processes. The objective of REACH and as well what we do at ECHA is to ensure the safe use of chemicals. And for that, we have a regulatory strategy in which it is described how this objective should be achieved. And the focus there is on substances for which regulatory action is expected to result in the largest improvement regarding the protection of human health and the environment, and that are then the substances that matter. This regulatory strategy has certain steps, and at the beginning there is an integrated selection and prioritization of something happens with okay, so integrated selection and prioritization of substances that raise a potential concern either with regard to their hazard properties or with regard that relevant information is missing or with regard to exposure. And there is then as well integrated then to determine the suitable route to address the concern. When a concern is confirmed, then we ensure that there is efficient follow-up. When information is missing, this is addressed then by substance evaluation or by compliance check of the registration dossiers in order to fill the information gaps. And once then there is a real a concern, then as well the appropriate risk management options are determined in a risk management option analysis. And this risk management option analysis is then usually followed up by a proposal for regulatory action, be that harmonized classification or labeling, SVHC identification with subsequent prioritization for is an authorization list or a restriction. And with that approach, for the substances where we do not identify a concern, we can then safely conclude that there is currently no or a lower priority for regulatory action. That is the REACH machinery, and it starts with the screening of the registration data, but for that as well other information is taken into account, so external information. It's not only the registration data, but the registration data is the basis. I explain it in further detail in a minute. So it starts with a screening and then identification of substances with a potential concern. And then it's clarified in the next step whether there is need for further information. If this is the case, then this information needs to be generated. And if standard information, so standard information requirements, what the registrants are legally required to provide is missing, then the dossier is subjected to compliance check. And if it is necessary to go further and to assess whether the substance has really properties of concern, hazard properties of concern, then we go to substance evaluation. And for these complex cases under substance evaluation, which are mainly the PPT and the ED assessments, we have as well an expert group or two expert groups at ECHA that can give then the evaluating member states non-binding scientific advice on the assessment of these substances. So if then the information is generated, then it goes further on to the clarification of the concern. And if the concern is confirmed, the risk management option analysis is carried out, and the result can be then theoretically still no action, or it is regulatory risk management under REACH, which would be harmonized classification and labeling, or SVHC identification and then authorization or restriction. Or it could as well be in action under in another legislative framework, like, for example, deriving of occupational exposure levels. I'm coming now to the common screening approach, which is part of this REACH machinery. And here you can see that we use for the screening all available data, so which is the Euclid database, but as well the classification and labeling inventory and all external sources that are suitable and accessible to us. And then there is then in this screening process an assignment to the correct channels for further assessment. So in case information is missing, as I already mentioned, substance evaluation or compliance check, or if all information is available, it could as well directly go to the regulatory risk management if a concern is identified. But it is quite rare now that we have that we find substances where the information is so far available that we could directly go to this REACH process before at least the substance evaluation is carried out and further information generated. The advantage of this approach is that we screen only once and screen for all our regulatory processes and do that in a systematic manner, and by that use optimally our resources. We avoid parallel processing of the substances, and we ensure that we choose the most effective regulatory option for each substance. So, the objective of this common screening approach is then to identify among the this potentially hazardous substances those which have a high tonnage for wide dispersive uses and which have uses in the scope of substance evaluation, harmonized classification, labeling and authorization or restriction. And in the scope is important because some substances or uses are exempted from this processes, and this we consider as well. Achieved is this identification of the substances then by IT-based combination of hazard information and use and exposure information, and by that we then get the substances that matter identified. As hazard information, as I already mentioned, we use their all available data, and that are then the REACH registrations, which are in Euclid, all the CLL notifications, external regulatory programs or lists like the SIN list or the commission list of potential endocrine disruptors, as examples now only, and as well predictive mass structural alerts, QSR modeling, and so on. And there is then a search for either indications of hazard data or gaps in the hazard endpoints, so which would then require that these gaps are filled. So we are not only looking for indication of a hazard, but as well for information gaps that would not allow to conclude whether there is for a specific endpoint a hazard. And the focus is on what we call super endpoints, and that is carcinogenicity, mutagenicity, toxicity for reproduction, sensitization, endocrine disruption for human health and for the environment, PBT, VBVB properties, and endocrine disrupting properties. Exposure information, that is again based on the registration dossiers, and the overall tonnage is used at the moment. We would prefer to use tonnage by use, but that information is not available. And then information that on whether a specific use falls under REACH or CLP regulatory action. As I already mentioned, some of the uses are exempted from some of the regulatory actions. And then as well indication on widespread professional uses, consumer uses, and article service life, and potential for human exposure. And we use as well external sources, like for example, the chemical data reporting database of the US EPA and the substances in preparation in Nordic countries databases. So far to this ID-based first screening step, which gives us an over all registrations that are in ECHA's database, in principle a priority list of substances. And from this IT-based list, ECHA prepares a short list of approximately 250 substances, which then in a second step are what we call manually screened by the member states, so further scrutinized whether the concern is really justified, or at least justified so far that it merits further investigation, because it is only a short screening per substance, probably a day or at most 2 days, in order to go to the registration dossiers and manually check whether so the IT routines did a good job, or so whether the initial concern is so far justified that it would merit a full assessment. So that this is a very preliminary assessment. And then the member states normally select about 200 substances per year. That is the capacity that can be channeled to the regulatory processes. And make some proposals in which process the substances should go. And as you can see here in the pie chart, so the percentage is unfortunately lost. That is a breakdown of the portions that go to the different processes. But what you can see here is that approximately 60% go to information generation. That is substance evaluation, and that is compliance check. Then this here is no action. So that means that about 80% of the substances that on IT-based screening have been identified as substance of potential concern are set aside after manual screening because there doesn't seem to be concern. But 80% are moved on. The bulk of that goes first to information generation and not directly to processes like risk management, option analysis, or classification and labeling. And this screening is carried out once per year. And substances that are not selected in the screening process of a particular year are going back to the big pool and are screened again in the coming years, because information in the registrations, primarily on uses but as well on risks, may change so that they are redundantly screened. So we do never set substances aside forever. So now coming to how we consider groups in the screening process. And why are we doing this grouping? That is in the first hand to enhance the coherence of our work through all the steps from screening via the further information generation to the regulatory risk management, and as well to maximize the efficiency of our available resources and to support industry in avoiding, and that is as well a very important point, to do regrettable substitution. That means to replace one substance that is a problematic by another problematic substance. With regards to the methodologies that are applied, that is at the moment mainly based on structural similarity of the substances, but as well on proposed read across in the registration dossiers, but as well on established categories established by OECD or under other regulatory regimes. There are, of course, as well other ways of grouping, like grouping according to similar uses, common technical function, common mode of action, common metabolites, biodegradation or hydrolysis products. And we are at the moment internally piloting and developing such grouping methodologies for the implementation, but that is in an initial stage, but that will come in the future. We have as well or apply grouping as well under other regulatory processes, and I have here two examples. One is prioritization of groups of substances of very high concern for inclusion in Annex 14, so the list of substances which are subject to authorization, whereas for example certain chromium compounds have been added as groups or lead in arsenic compounds, but as well phthalates. And if in this group new substances are identified as a substance of very high concern, they are then in the step where the where ECHA has to propose to the Commission which substances should be included in Annex 14, have then as well priority and are usually then proposed to be as well included in Annex 14 to complement the group. And as well for substance SVHC identification itself, we use grouping approaches, for example, because the group of a certain group of substances has a degradation product with SVHC properties. That was for example, the case for the 4-nonyl and 4-tert octylphenol ethoxylates. But we're pursuing a similar strategy at the moment for certain perfluorinated compounds, which as well have a common degradation product. And via that, we want to address then the parent compounds. So with that, I'm at the end of my talk. And thank you for your attention. And give the floor back to the chair.